Hi, everybody. Welcome back. When you think of the United States National Park System, and if I were to ask you to imagine a national park, one of the first images that might come to mind, even if you have never been there, is the image of Yosemite National Park. This view that you see here on the screen, this is what you would see as you're coming out of the tunnel and you're turning into the parking lot to what we call tunnel view. This is exactly what you would see as you pull up in the parking lot. It's this beautiful, vast array of granite or granodiorite, which is an intrusive igneous rock. All of Yosemite National Park is formed from this beautiful intrusive igneous rock. If you were to look at that igneous rock up close, this is an example here of what is known as a half-dome granodiorite. You can see that it's made up of multiple different mineral types, including quartz. It also includes feldspars that are white or pink. A type of amphibole known as hornblende, that's a very specific type of amphibole, as well as biotite, a sheet silicate that's black or dark brown. That's what makes up the granodiorite that forms Half Dome Peak. It's really incredible that an entire national park is formed by igneous rocks. In this video, we're going to talk about what igneous rocks are generally and the different types that you might come across. We're going to talk about the causes of melting because igneous rocks form from molten rock. So we want to know what causes melting in the first place. And we're going to talk about different forms of intrusive igneous rocks. So what types of geometries you might expect igneous rocks to form under the crust and within the crust. So let's get started. We're talking specifically about igneous rocks here, so I'm going to go into some general types of igneous rocks and what you might expect from them. So what is an igneous rock exactly? It's a rock that has cooled and crystallized from molten rock, either magma or lava. Remember that magma is any molten rock that is below the surface of the earth. Lava, on the other hand, is molten rock at the surface of the earth that has extruded out of the earth. We generally classify igneous rocks by their composition and their texture. So composition being what they're made out of, so what minerals form the igneous rock, and the texture being, you know, what the grains and the crystals that make up the rock, what those actually look like. Are they large? Are they small? Can you see them with your naked eye? Can you see them with a hand lens? Do they have vesicles? Do they have little air pockets in them? That's what we call texture. And we'll get into the more specifics of texture a little bit later. Also, we classify igneous rocks based on their composition. So there are four general categories of composition, although if you ask an igneous petrologist to talk about the different compositions igneous rocks come in, they could wax poetic about how many different compositions of igneous rocks there are. So we're just going to focus on four main types. That's ultramafic, mafic, intermediate, and felsic. Igneous rocks are also either extrusive or intrusive. So they either have extruded out of the earth, they are volcanic, they have erupted at the surface, or they're intrusive and they have cooled and crystallized below the surface of the earth. So those are different ways of thinking about igneous rocks. So as I mentioned, you can sort of get this chemical variability or variation in composition within igneous rocks. And that has to do with a couple of things. It has to do with the proportion of mafic minerals in the rock. So mafic is a term that comes from magnesium and the Latin word for iron. So if a rock is mafic, or if a mineral is mafic, a mafic mineral, it has a lot of magnesium and iron in it. A common mafic mineral is something like olivine. That's a magnesium silicate. Another way of thinking of these different compositions are in the proportion of silica in the rock. So a felsic rock has a large quantity of silica, that SiO2. It has 67 to 76% silica. Ultramafic magmas, on the other hand, or ultramafic rocks, have much less silica, 38 to 45%. So you can think of these four categories having to do with either the proportion of silica, or the proportion of mafic minerals, magnesium and iron. Another thing to know about these varying compositions is that you're going to find different minerals in these different rocks. So rocks that are ultramafic or mafic are going to have a high olivine and pyroxene content. They're going to have mostly olivine pyroxene. Mafic rocks are going to also have plagioclase in them. And then as you move to the more felsic rocks, you're going to see less olivine and pyroxene and more plagioclase, biotite, potassium feldspar. And in felsic rocks, you'll see a lot of quartz. We'll get into the details of why this happens later, but I just want you to understand that there are these four main compositional categories. There are also two types of igneous rocks generally if you're thinking about where they're forming. As I mentioned before, there are intrusive igneous rocks, and you can think about these having been intruded into the country rock. The country rock in the crust is rock that was already there, so it could be any type of rock, it's just pre-existing. An intrusive igneous rock is an igneous rock that has pushed its way into the country rock. These rocks are inside the earth, so hopefully that helps you remember intrusive rocks. Generally, these types of rocks cool relatively slowly. They're in the crust where it's a little bit warmer, and there's more time for larger crystals to form. So they tend to be coarse-grained, where you can actually see the individual minerals with your naked eye just by looking at the rock. So this is a good example of a granite, where if you look a little bit closer, if you were to bring that sample up to your eye, you would be able to identify different minerals like biotite, maybe muscovite, and quartz. Extrusive igneous rocks, on the other hand, have now exited Earth and they're now at the surface. Comparatively, these cool quickly, so there's not a lot of time for large crystals to develop. So we typically call these are typically fine-grained rocks, rocks where you can't see individual crystals. The crystals are there, but they're just very small. On the right here are a few samples of basalt. So if I were to take this sample of basalt and hold it up to my eye, I wouldn't be able to identify the individual crystals. Maybe I'll see that they're individual crystals, but I won't be able to tell what they are. In this photo here, you can see basalt that has overrun this road in Hawaii, where we get a lot of these effusive, extrusive igneous eruptions. So now let's talk a little bit about the causes of melting. So igneous rocks obviously come from molten rock, but how does that rock melt in the first place? There are a few main types of melting that we're going to talk about here. The first is decompression melting. Now, it's a bit of a misconception that rock in the mantle is liquid. Really, it's under so much pressure that it behaves as a solid in most places. However, if you were to release that pressure, it would allow the rock to actually melt. So here are a couple of things I want to point out on this diagram on the far left. So this black line here is what we call the geothermal gradient, or the geotherm for short. And what this illustrates is the change in temperature with depth in the crust and the upper mantle. There's also a green line here. This is the solidus. So as the rock would intersect this green line, that's where the rock would begin to melt. It wouldn't melt entirely, but parts of it would begin to melt. The red line here is the liquidus. This is where rocks go from being partially melted to being completely liquid, to being completely molten. So with decompression melting specifically, this is when you would take a rock that is in its solid state, it's somewhere here on the geotherm, and you were to move it up toward the solidus. You would move it to an area where that rock can begin to melt. So with decompression melting, you're not changing the temperature, you're not moving left and right on this chart, you're just moving up or down. So in this case, we're moving up, we're taking the pressure off, and that's going to allow the rock to begin to melt. So there are a few tectonic environments where you might expect decompression melting to occur. One of these might be at a mantle plume, or where you would find a hotspot volcano, like Hawaii, for example, where the crust is relatively thin, there's not a lot of mass above the mantle, and it allows decompression melting to occur. You also would expect decompression melting beneath rifts, so continental rifts where you have two continental plates that are sort of beginning to pull apart, and so they're being stretched very thin. That allows sort of this upwarping of the asthenosphere and decompression of the mantle. You also would expect decompression melting below a mid-ocean ridge, so where the oceanic crust has split, and that's relieving the pressure and allowing the rock to melt. The next type of melting that I want to talk to you about is when you've added volatiles to the system. So we also call this flux melting in geology. This is when you're adding things like water and carbon dioxide to the rock. And what that does is it lowers the melting temperature, and the rock is allowed to melt at lower temperatures than it typically would. This is super common in subduction zones, places where we have oceanic crust subducting beneath continental crust. In places like this, you have ocean water, sea water being incorporated into sediments on the bottom of the seafloor, and those sediments are being subducted down into the crust, and so you have a high water content, higher than you typically would have. So that addition of volatiles like water allows the rock to melt at an earlier or at a lower temperature than it typically would. The last cause of melting that I want to talk about is heat transfer. And this one's probably the easiest to wrap your head around. As you have hot magma rising through the lithosphere, it has the ability to heat the surrounding country rock. This type of melting can occur in just about any tectonic setting. It can occur in rifts, at convergent boundaries like subduction zones, and at hot spots. Anywhere where magma can carry heat up in the crust, you can get this heat transfer melting. Okay, now let's talk about different forms of igneous intrusions. So we're talking intrusive igneous rocks specifically. Rocks that are forming from magma down in the crust. They haven't been extruded out onto the surface. The first types of igneous intrusions that I'm going to talk about are dikes and sills. Dikes and sills are both tabular intrusions. So they're it's these sheets of magma, or these tabular shapes of magma that are pushing themselves through sedimentary layers. Sedimentary rocks are typically laid down in layers, these planar layers of rock. Dikes are any tabular intrusion that cuts across these sedimentary layers, and sills are any tabular intrusions that sort of push themselves between those sedimentary layers. There are a few really good diagrams here that can help you imagine what these might look like. Here's an example of a dike that's cutting across layers and sills that are pushing between layers. And these names and definitions don't change regardless of the orientation of the sedimentary layers. So dikes always cut across and sills always push in between. If you were to remove the sedimentary layers, in this case it's a sandstone, if you were to remove that sandstone, you would see the cooled and crystallized tabular intrusions, your dike that was cutting across the sedimentary layers and the sills that were pushing in between the layers. So here's a really excellent real-life example of both dikes and sills. This is an outcrop in Utah, and the white rock here is an intrusive igneous rock. It's extremely felsic. There's not a lot of magnesium or iron that makes up this rock, so it's really light in color. And it has intruded into a pre-existing sedimentary rock. You can even still see the layers of bedding within this sedimentary rock. It's this darker rock right here. You can see that the felsic igneous rock has pushed its way in between those layers. So we have a number of sills here. It has also pushed its way across the sedimentary layer. So there are a few dikes in this example as well. Again, just a really excellent example of a real life intrusion. The next type of intrusion I want to talk about are plutons. So plutons are basically any irregularly shaped blob of an intrusion that are, you know, tens of meters across in size to tens of kilometers across in size. So quite a range of sizes that you can get for plutons, but they can be fairly small to fairly large. It just depends. There are some great illustrations here on the slide that I think are really helpful. I like to think of Plutons a little bit like a lava lamp. So you have the two different colors of lava. It's not real lava. And really, it would be magma. But let's not get into the details of that. You can think of Plutons as like the rising blobs in your lava lamp, right? They're warm. They are pushing up through the pre-existing rock. And they're just these three-dimensionally blob-like shapes. You have to remember that all of these diagrams, even though these are two-dimensional illustrations, these are actually three-dimensional shapes. They're three-dimensional bulbous shapes within the crust. Once these rocks get exposed at the surface of the Earth to a place where we can actually observe them, like in the previous example, I showed you some exposed dikes and sills in real life. This is an example of what an exposed Pluton would look like. So this Pluton cooled below the surface of the Earth, and then because of uplift and erosion processes that we'll talk about in a different video, because of those processes, it's been exposed to the surface and we can now observe it as geologists. So here in this example of a Pluton, we have a granite. So it's a granite Pluton that is coming into contact with some other type of rock, some other pre-existing wall rock. And those places where the granite and the wall rock meet, we call that a contact. It's a contact between two different types of rocks. One process that's important to know when we're talking about igneous intrusions is a process called stoping. And that's a process in which magma assimilates pre-existing wall rock. So you can imagine that you have this magma that's rising through the crust, and it might grab a little bit of the wall rock and assimilate it into the magma. Sometimes that assimilated rock gets melted and incorporated in the magma, or it might not melt, and later when it's exposed again at the surface where we can observe it, you might see something that we call a xenolith. So that's a rock like this one here in the picture that has not been fully melted. It just sort of went along for a ride in the magma and wasn't able to melt. So that's what we call a xenolith. It's a pre-existing rock that has somehow been preserved within a body, within a magmatic body. So finally, we're going to talk about the largest igneous intrusions, batholiths. Batholiths are essentially any igneous intrusion that is several hundred kilometers long and about 100 kilometers wide or more. These are formed by multiple smaller Plutons in the same region. In Western North America, we have a number of batholiths available for our own observation. In fact, right in the backyard at Sierra College, we have the Sierra Nevada batholith. So this north-south trending batholith of granodiorites that includes Yosemite National Park. In Idaho, we have the Idaho batholith. In Canada, the Coast Ranges batholith, and down south of us, we have the peninsular batholith in Mexico. So these are all igneous intrusions, very large, vast, hundreds of kilometer scale intrusions that are fairly old and now have been exposed at the surface of the Earth for us to observe. Finally, just a couple of other interesting geometries that you might come across when it comes to igneous intrusions. So we previously talked about sills and dikes, batholiths. There's another term that we call a stock, which is typically even smaller than a Pluton. There's another word for a Pluton, just a smaller scale. There are also intrusions called laccoliths, which are igneous intrusions similar to a sill. So they're squeezing up between sedimentary layers. But a laccolith has actually pushed some of those sedimentary layers up around it, and it forms a fold above the laccolith. We can also get lopoliths, which are, again, intrusions into sedimentary layers, in between layers, but lopoliths are sort of pressing those sedimentary layers down rather than up, so it's causing a fold below the intrusion. So I hope this video was helpful in you getting to know igneous rocks, specifically intrusive igneous rocks. We sort of defined what an igneous rock is. We talked about the different causes of melting, and I went into nerdy detail about the different forms of intrusive igneous rocks. So I hope this was helpful, and I look forward to seeing you in the next video.